We have always got along fine with the niggas. We never mistreated them. And there's no complaints. And they are all happy. They are all happy.
We was asking with the Panthers. We was asking with them, you know, civil rights movement. We was asking, you know, now those people that were asking, they're all dead and in jail. So now what do you think we're gonna do? Ask?
And it simply says exactly what black people have been crying for 400 years.
If you don't break the cycle, history repeats. If you don't crash the system, it reboots. If you don't eliminate the virus, it thrives. This is the algorithm of white supremacy. An algorithm is a list of steps followed to finish a task. The task or objective of white supremacy has always been the same: domination. Rather, your present is 1619, 1775, 1863, 1968, 2020, or 100 years in the future. If this algorithm has not been ended, then its goal will remain the same. Despite the rising and falling of nations and institutions, the algorithm of white supremacy's reach is global. Its history is evil, and its effects have been injected deeply into the present. Focus your senses, open your eyes, ignore all distractions, and upload this information into your mind. Jesus Christ, do you think he'd really agree with what you devils did? I thought he said, without love, you have nothing. Are you sure we are looking in the same book? The Supreme Pontiff, commonly known as the Pope, is the worldwide leader of the Catholic Church. He determines what is acceptable for millions of people worldwide. His words and decrees are taken as the word of God. He is believed to be free of error. This is called papal infallibility. In 1452, Pope Nicholas V issued a papal bull known as Dum Diversus. A papal bull is an official proclamation or decree issued by the Pope. With his words being seen as that of God's, Pope Nicholas issued Dum Diversus, which had a disastrous effect on Africa. In the 1400s, there were laws clearly regulating who Christians could and could not enslave. When Portuguese ships began returning with slaves from West Africa, Pope Nicholas V addressed the issue of how to treat what he referred to as pagans. He gave King Alfonso of Portugal the right to invade, search out, capture, and subdue all Saracens and pagans whatsoever, and other enemies of Christ wheresoever placed, and the kingdoms, dukedoms, principalities, dominions, possessions, and all movable and immovable goods whatsoever held and possessed by them, and to reduce their persons to perpetual slavery. Let's put that in other words. The Pope gave a European king the right to invade in Jesus' name, conquer in Jesus' name, steal in Jesus' name, and enslave in Jesus' name. Yet the man believed to be Jesus' representative on earth, a man whose words are put on par with that of God's, a man believed to be free of error, the most holy living being on the planet, was actually the devil. And may his name rot in the bowels of history forever. In Jesus' name.
After the hunt, it is not the prey who authors the story, but the hunters. Rest assured that the authors will justify all of their murderous ways and forgive themselves for their prey's destruction. And as the survivors scramble, attempting to rebuild their former lives, the hunters will do all they can to silence them. Devil. A long line of justifications led Europe to perpetrate one of the worst atrocities ever, the transatlantic slave trade. Even to this day, people attempt to justify the slave trade by saying that European slave traders purchased slaves from Africans. They'll go just far enough into the past to blame the oppression of black people on black people. Yet the truth is more complex than they can handle. There is bound to be some snakes in every group of people. European slave traders took advantage of this for their own benefit at the cost of countless black lives. Although some Africans participated in the slave trade, many fought against it, building fortifications around their villages and assigning lookouts to alert the people. The fight continued aboard the ship in the form of rebellions, hunger strikes, and even suicide. The transatlantic slave trade haunted the people of Africa, and they fought against it. Africans also did not view the slave trade as selling their own people, as they did not have a united black identity, as some people ignorantly suggest when they say that Africans sold their own people into slavery. Africans were not united. The Europeans were the ones who were united. They were united in their desire to have black slaves. Slavery wasn't new, but what the Europeans brought to it was a deeply racial connotation justified by their highest religious official, the Pope. It was the Europeans who created, ran, and heavily benefited from the intricately complex and economically lucrative system of the transatlantic slave trade. A symphony of sorrow and death, the longest forced movement of people ever recorded, spanning centuries. Hundreds of bodies would be packed together tightly, chained to the bottom of a ship. Initially, merchant ships were modified for use in the slave trade. In time, they began building ships specifically to carry slaves on. There wasn't enough space to stand, and the air was foul as people lay dead, scared, and alone in their own bodily waste. This was the Middle Passage. Traders bought Africans with European goods and took them from West Africa across the Atlantic Ocean to what the Europeans called the New World. Some estimates say that 10 to 15% of Africans died during the voyage, which lasted nearly 3 months. The survivors were sold as slaves in return for goods such as sugar, rum, and molasses, and the slave traders turned around and went back to Europe to start the journey over again. And they hail Western civilization as the pinnacle of humanity, when indeed it seems to be the pinnacle of inhumanity. There was no age of exploration. There was no beauty in European colonization. The story of the American colonies is not some patriotic dream where America's manifest destiny was fulfilled. This was an invasion, a story all about benefiting from death, genocide, and perpetual servitude, causing problems and ignoring their effects even till this day. When we mention what happened, you look in the other direction. This evil was carried out against our people, we say. But you say blacks sold other blacks. It lasted centuries, we say. But you say it was a long time ago. It still has effects today, we say. But you say you were never a slave and I was never a slave owner. This is the algorithm of white supremacy. They always ignore, attack, or deny. If you don't break the cycle, history repeats. If you don't crash the system, it reboots.
We are African, and we happen to be in America. We're not American. We are people who formerly were Africans who were kidnapped and brought to America. Our forefathers weren't the pilgrims. We didn't land on Plymouth Rock. The rock was landed on us. We were brought here against our will. We were not brought here to be made citizens. Because we weren't brought here to be made citizens, today, now that we've become awakened to some degree and we begin to ask for those things which they say are supposedly for Americans, they look upon us with hostility and unfriendliness. We invested 310 years of slave labor, 310 years, every day of which your and my mother and father worked for nothing, not 8 hours a day. There was no union in that day. They worked from sun up until sundown, from can't see in the morning until can't see at night. They never had a day off. And on Sunday, they were allowed to sit down and sing about when they died, they wouldn't be slaves no more. When they died.
When they died.
In 1619, the year believed to have marked the first arrival of Africans in the colony of Virginia. In actuality, captive Africans were present in what would become the United States for over 100 years before 1619, as the European trade of Africans began in the mid-1400s. Throughout the years, many have claimed that the first slave ship was named Jesus. Although claiming a first slave ship is difficult, it is true that the first major English trader did use a boat named Jesus of Lubeck. John Hawkins was said to have been a devout Christian, often holding service on board and telling his crew to serve God and love one another, all while plundering ships, stealing slaves, and lying to Africans to lure them to the New World. Africans entered into this New World. A new world that Europe granted itself access to by invading, spreading disease, killing natives, and continually breaking treaties. They were sold at slave auctions, inspected like cattle, having their mouths pried open, their muscles squeezed, their bodies violated, separated from families, and brought to a place unfamiliar to them, a place to build a world for those who had destroyed theirs. What happens when you subjugate a group of people to the lowest levels of society? The people will always fight their oppressor. But many make the ignorant claim that enslaved people in America did not fight back, but rather waited for the North to end slavery. They never heard of the Stono Rebellion of 1739, the German Coast Uprising of 1811, or Nat Turner's Rebellion. But the slave owners had heard of these, and they were fearful of being killed in uprisings. In order to calm their fears, laws regulating the actions and treatment of slaves, known as slave codes, were written into law. Enslaved people had to have written permission from their overseer to travel, and if they attempted to run, they could be branded with an R on their cheek, have their hamstrings cut, or be killed. Blacks were prohibited from owning weapons, and if they were caught doing so, they would receive 39 lashes and have their weapon confiscated. If an enslaved person attempted to defend themselves from their master, the slaveholder had the right to kill them. Enslaved people were considered property, so they were prohibited from owning property. Blacks accused of any crime against a white person were sentenced to death by all white juries. There were even laws punishing whites if they attempted to help enslaved people. It was illegal for slaves to read and write. Anyone caught teaching them how to do so was subject to large fines and up to 6 months in jail. They were also prohibited from congregating due to the fear of them organizing to fight against their own oppression. If a black man was accused of raping a white woman, he would be castrated or executed, all while the bodies of enslaved women were free to be violated without repercussion. Children born to enslaved women were born as slaves, and in most cases, died as slaves. But you, dear listener, were never a slave. This has no effect on the present, or at least that's what they'd like you to believe. We are playing an infinite game of dominoes. Not the type that you slam on the table when you win, the type that children often play when they carefully stack dominoes up on their ends, making a long, winding line of dotted tiles. If done carefully enough, tipping over the first tile will cause a chain reaction that will cause the next to fall, and the next, and so forth until the final tile falls. Now, once they all fall, what reasonable human would suggest that the falling of the first tile had nothing to do with the falling of the last? How is it that they can trace their dominoes all the way back to the Pilgrims and identify that as a monumental moment that shaped their history, but they can't seem to understand how slavery monumentally shaped Black history? Because you were never a slave. It is all by design. The algorithm of white supremacy must deny all attempts to crash the system. The American Revolution, the war fought by the 13 colonies to free themselves from the British Empire, a pivotal moment where the Founding Fathers forged their way into history forever. According to your history teacher, the American Revolution is essentially a patriotic dream where heroes were born and the destiny of a nation was set. Give me liberty or give me death. What is liberty to this man? What liberty was Patrick Henry so ready to die for that he denied it to others? A giant among men, this revolutionary founding father bought and sold slaves throughout his life and owned 67 slaves at the time of his death. Yet in his writings, he clearly states that owning slaves is evil. What a hypocrite. But he was in good company. Thomas Jefferson, one of the most influential founding fathers to come out of the Revolution, the man who penned the Declaration of Independence, in which the colonists informed King George of their decision to split from the British Empire, leading to the creation of the United States, the man who wrote the immortal words forever etched in history. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by the Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And if all men are created equally, then why did Thomas Jefferson himself have slaves? Why did he have a sexual relationship with an underaged enslaved woman by the name of Sally Hemings? Something that today we would call statutory rape. Did he really believe that all men were created equally? Such beautiful words inspired many Blacks to join the fight against the British. Around 9,000 Black men fought for the Continental Army, many of which were promised their freedom in return for their service, although at the end of the war, a number of slave owners failed to keep their promise. In contrast to the 9,000 Blacks fighting for the colonies, 20,000 enslaved people fought for the British Army, who also had promised them freedom. Yet, at the end of the war, many of them were enslaved by the very men who had filled their heads with false promises as they fled the colonies to become slaves in Jamaica or St. Augustine. Africans fighting against the United States was revisited during the War of 1812, in which the United States fought and defeated Great Britain once again. America's national anthem, the Star Spangled Banner, was written by Francis Scott Key during the War of 1812. It was initially a poem called Defense of Fort McHenry. Key had written it as he witnessed the British Navy bombard the fort in what would lead to an American victory and the proud flying of the U.S. flag. In the third stanza of the Star Spangled Banner, Key addresses the Black refugees who had joined the British in hopes of gaining their freedom, threatening slaves that fought against the United States with death, writing, "No refuge could save the hireling and slave from the terror of flight or the gloom of the grave.
We're proud of our country. We respect our flag. Wouldn't you love to see one of these NFL owners, when somebody disrespects our flag, to say, get that son of a bitch off the field right now, out, he's fired. He's fired!
I mean, ultimately, it's to bring awareness and make people, you know, realize what's really going on in this country. There are a lot of things that are going on that are unjust, people aren't being held accountable for, and that's something that needs to change. That's something that, you know, this country stands for freedom, liberty, justice for all. And it's not happening for all right now.
Get that son of a bitch off the field right now.
The American Civil War. Nearly a century had passed since Thomas Jefferson had written the Declaration of Independence, and the United States continually failed at living up to its promises of freedom and equality. Enter Abraham Lincoln, another monumental figure in American history. According to your history teacher, Lincoln was a savior for the black community, a selfless man who gave his life fighting to abolish slavery. Lincoln emerges as a benevolent hero. The Civil War is often used to silence black voices and ignore the effects of our history. People say there was an entire war fought to free the slaves. People died to set your ancestors free. What we should be asking is, why did it take America centuries to wake up to the evils of slavery? And why were Americans still willing to die to preserve it? The Confederate States of America were formed after Lincoln became president, in fear that he would bring slavery to an end. But the truth is, Lincoln was not an abolitionist. Abolitionists believed that slavery should be ended immediately. While Lincoln viewed slavery as a moral wrong, he did not seek to bring it to an end. During the peak of the Civil War, in his own words, Lincoln wrote, "If I could save the Union without freeing any slave, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing all the slaves, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing some and leaving others alone, I would also do that." In other words, although Lincoln thought slavery was morally wrong, his primary goal was keeping the United States together, regardless of whether slavery was abolished or not. The Emancipation Proclamation is commonly believed to have abolished slavery. This is not true. Many who believe so most likely have never actually read the document itself. The Emancipation Proclamation was a military measure taken by President Lincoln to destabilize the South and rally escaped slaves to fight for the Union. Lincoln writes, "I further declare and make known that such persons of suitable condition will be received into the armed service of the United States to garrison forts, positions, stations, and other places, and to man vessels of all sorts in said service." The proclamation only applied to states that were in rebellion. This was an attempt to destabilize the South from within. This doesn't mean that the Emancipation Proclamation was not an important document or that it did not help lead to full abolition. Lincoln's participation in the eventual abolition of slavery and his tragic assassination at the end of the Civil War propelled him into sainthood. But how did a man known as the Great Emancipator really feel about black people? These are words from his own mouth. "I am not, nor ever have been, in favor of bringing about in any way the social and political equality of white and black races. I am not, nor ever have been, in favor of making voters or jurors of Negroes, nor of qualifying them to hold office, nor to intermarry with white people. And I will say in addition to this that there is a physical difference between the white and black races which I believe will forever forbid the two races living together on terms of social and political equality. While they do remain together, there must be the position of superior and inferior. And I, as much as any other man, am in favor of having the superior position assigned to the white race. I do not understand the belief that because I do not want a Negro woman for a slave, that I must necessarily want her for a wife. Those aren't the quotes you'll see etched in stone around the Lincoln Memorial. Lincoln believed that free slaves should be sent to either Africa or Central America. He even attempted to get support for his plan prior to writing the Emancipation Proclamation on the basis that whites and blacks could not live together peacefully. Stop and digest this information. Why am I telling you this? Remember the algorithm. If you don't crash the system, it reboots. And Abraham Lincoln showed us how the system works. Even one of the most influential individuals who played a major role in the abolition of slavery was racist. The system of white supremacy took a deep blow when slavery ended. Yet the system was immediately rebooting in the minds of those who helped deliver the blow. Lincoln is a picture of many white Northerners who believed slavery to be wrong, but also did not believe in true equality for blacks. How are we to view the individuals who gave with one hand and took with the other? Every time black people are freed from a system of oppression, a new one is created in an instant.
I'm the minstrel man, the cleaning man, the pole man, the shoe shine man. I'm a nigger man. Watch me dance. Shit. Yeah, I got the devil in me. Been waiting on welfare line, unemployment line, gas line since 9. Now I'm waiting on the pawn shop line. Hey, I got the devil in me. Been shot on, pushed on, gassed on, passed on, red, white, and blue on. Now I'm waiting to turn on. Yeah, I got the devil in me. It's the man you see. I'm a natural black face, and up my sleeve I'm holding an ace that I won't die in disgrace. If I stop dancing and don't let you blow me anymore in the wind, 'cause I refuse to come.
Help! Rape! Rape!
Over 600,000 people died during the Civil War. After the Union victory, the process of reintegrating Southern states and managing the rights and lives of newly freed slaves began. This era is known as the Reconstruction. In late 1865, the 13th Amendment was ratified, officially abolishing slavery in the United States. Abraham Lincoln was assassinated just a few short months prior to its ratification, and his vice president, Andrew Johnson, became the new president. Johnson's era is known as Presidential Reconstruction, in which the president actively fought against rights for blacks. Johnson believed in the idea of Herrenvolk democracy, which meant that the least white man should be higher than the greatest black man. The term Herrenvolk itself means master race. Scared white Southerners questioned their place within the social hierarchy of the South, and their fears grew as newly freed slaves were given more rights. In contrast to Andrew Johnson's presidential reconstruction, which wanted to keep blacks as a permanent underclass, there was radical reconstruction, which attempted to provide freedoms and protections for blacks. Supporters of radical reconstruction helped pass the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. They also set up the Freedmen's Bureau, which helped former slaves and poor whites in the South by providing health care, food, housing, legal assistance, and education. Agents of the Bureau were essentially social workers for ex-slaves. They were subject to threats and violence from white supremacists attempting to limit anything blacks could gain from the organization. President Johnson fought against the Freedmen's Bureau, sometimes firing agents who he believed to be too sympathetic to ex-slaves. Even within the Bureau, there were fights over how the government should help blacks and for how long. Blacks were even appointed to Congress during the Reconstruction. This is a little known fact. Hiram Rhodes Revels was the first African-American senator to serve in Congress, representing Mississippi in 1870 and 1871 during the Reconstruction. White Southerners attempted to stop Revels from taking the position, but failed. Revels was a strong proponent for racial equality. The last black congressman from the South served until 1901. There wouldn't be another black person elected to Congress from one of the 11 former Confederate states until 1973. Two of history's forgotten white supremacist groups, known as the Red Shirts and the White League, arose in response to new freedoms given to ex-slaves. They discouraged blacks from voting and participating in the government through violence and intimidation, assassinating both black leaders and sympathetic whites. The red shirt became a symbol of resistance against black freedom. Racist whites wore it with pride. They surely believed that they could make America great again by perpetually denying blacks a great America. The Southern states passed new black codes, attempting to control black labor as well as many other freedoms. In some states, blacks who had jobs other than a servant or farmer were forced to pay annual fines. Some states required blacks to have employment contracts each year. If they left before the contract ended, they could be arrested, forced to forfeit their wages, or be placed back into forced labor. Jim Crow laws legalized segregation. Blacks were forbidden from living in white neighborhoods, using white bathrooms or water fountains, and in Atlanta, blacks were even given a different Bible to swear on while in court. Jim Crow laws legally ruled all areas of black life until the passing of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. At the end of Reconstruction, white Southerners successfully subjugated blacks to the very bottom of society.
I'm all alone in this house. Isn't anybody else interested in upholding standards? Our world is coming crumbling down. The coons are coming.
Archie, 12% of the population is black. There should be a lot of black families living out here.
Yeah, this is only a beginning, but I think it's wonderful.
Wonderful, huh? Well, let's see how wonderful it is when a watermelon rinds come flying out the window.
In the name of the greatest people that have ever trod this earth, I draw the line in the dust and toss the gauntlet before the feet of tyranny, and I say segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever.
Today, people would lead you to believe that poverty in the black community is solely a result of laziness, while, in actuality, poverty was created and maintained by the government. After Reconstruction, Jim Crow laws and other black codes worked to confine blacks to the lowest levels of society. When the idea of home ownership became part of the American dream, blacks were systematically kept away from it. The Great Depression had a disastrous effect on the American economy. Home ownership rates plunged to all-time lows. How come when blacks live in poverty, it is viewed as a problem from within? You must pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. But when whites live in poverty, it becomes a national issue that must be dealt with immediately. In the 1930s, as part of his New Deal to bring America out of the Depression, President Franklin Roosevelt passed various laws regarding housing. Roosevelt's reforms created the American middle class and placed many families into affordable homes. Unfortunately, his reforms were targeted at aiding whites, while blacks were stopped from participating in the growing middle class. While the Federal Housing Administration was building hundreds of thousands of homes and filling them with white families, they were also solidifying the practice of redlining. Redlining is the discriminatory practice of denying various housing services such as banking and insurance on the basis of race. In 1935, the Home Owners Loan Corporation was asked to create residential security maps that would help banks and real estate investors assess how safe their investments were. The most desirable areas with the newest infrastructure were outlined in green and designated as Type A. These areas were usually white suburbs, while the least desirable areas were outlined in red and labeled Type D. These were typically older areas where black people lived. The government refused to insure mortgages in high-risk areas, so banks rarely gave them. The obvious racial bias held within residential security maps gave federal support and justification for discriminatory practices from banks and real estate agents, effectively segregating the United States along lines that are still drawn today. Redlined areas were underfunded and neglected, becoming slums and ghettos that would be demolished. With property taxes determining school funding, black schools went heavily underfunded, leading to joblessness, more poverty, and crime. Even today, schools in predominantly white areas receive around $23 billion more dollars annually. Even after segregation was declared unconstitutional, racist whites would leave neighborhoods with growing black populations, a phenomenon known as white flight. But once those old structures that blacks were living in became trendy again, predominantly white investors swoop back in to gentrify the neighborhood, and the cycle continues today, and we haven't even scratched the surface. To view poverty in the black community as some type of inner defect that could be simply fixed by filling out a job application ignores 150 years of unfair housing practices designed to keep black people in substandard conditions. It ignores the fact that measures taken to limit discrimination, such as the 1968 Fair Housing Act, have been widely ignored by local and state governments. It ignores the lasting legacy of an era that refuses to remain in the past, unsurprisingly gaining new life from the president, who wrote, "I am happy to inform all of the people living their suburban lifestyle dream that you will no longer be bothered or financially hurt by having low-income housing built in your neighborhood. Your housing prices will go up based on the market, and crime will go down."
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
There are literally two Americas.
What they say reveals their deepest fears and frustrations. Why did you select Levittown to live?
We were looking for a place to buy a home. We looked at Levittown, and we liked the homes here. We liked the advantages that Levittown seemed to offer in comparison to other cities. And we understood that it was going to be all white, and we were very happy to buy a home here.
How about your children? Have you talked with them about the Myers?
I feel that it's something that we adults should solve without bringing the children into it any more than we have to. We're doing it for the children.
We're very interested in your house, and we'd like an application. And I remember what he said to me. He looked at me, he said, it's not me, but the management has not as yet decided whether he's going to sell these houses to Negroes or not. And,
You can't believe it. You really thought you had it made. You know, everything is falling into place.
Well, I'd like you to conceive that somebody telling you that, and there's no recourse, telling you that openly and outright like that.
Two Americas.
Despite discriminatory housing practices, black people were able to build thriving, self-sufficient towns. The most famous of which was the Greenwood District in Tulsa, Oklahoma, better known as Black Wall Street. In 1906, a wealthy African-American landowner known as O.W. Gurley purchased 40 acres of land in Tulsa, Oklahoma. He pledged to only sell land to blacks, as they were unable to participate in white society. By 1913, Greenwood had doctors and law offices, grocery stores, churches, hotels, drug stores, beauty salons, and barber shops. Yet hate would bring it all down. People living in the area surrounding Greenwood were becoming increasingly jealous of its growing prosperity. In 1921, tensions flared into an all-out massacre after a 17-year-old white girl, Sarah Page, accused Dick Rowland, a black teenager, of assaulting her on an elevator. The day following Rowland's arrest, the Tulsa Tribune ran a story labeled "Nab Negro for Attacking Girl in Elevator," in which they described the incident as an attempted assault. During this time, even an attempted assault on a white woman was treated like rape and could result in a lynching. It is notable to say that Sarah Page refused to press charges on Rowland. This gives great reason to assume his innocence. After an angry citizen called the Tulsa police commissioner and told them that they were going to lynch the black devil that assaulted that girl, Rowland was moved to a more secure cell on top of the courthouse. Black citizens feared the possibility of a lynching, so they armed themselves and went to the courthouse to protect Rowland. When a white man tried to wrestle a black man's gun away from him, it discharged. That is when all hell broke loose. The shooting at the courthouse started 2 hours of fighting in downtown Tulsa until the men who came to protect Rowland returned to Greenwood. Fears of a Negro uprising grew as skirmishes continued. The National Guard received orders to go into Greenwood and take unarmed blacks into protective custody. As Greenwood's residents and black workers from Tulsa's white districts were being forced into detention centers, angry whites descended into Greenwood, viciously massacring people, setting fires, stealing and destroying buildings. Even police officers who were supposed to help joined in. In the aftermath, an all-white jury blamed the massacre on Greenwood's black residents, and no whites were charged. Most of Greenwood's population of 10,000 people were left homeless, with over 6,000 living in internment camps for months. The Red Cross mounted a relief effort, drawing criticism for using taxpayer dollars to help the victims. Tulsa's white neighborhoods and businesses were not harmed during the riot. The story of Black Wall Street is famous, but it isn't the only one. The Rosewood Massacre took place in Florida just 2 years after Tulsa. 150 blacks were killed. What about the Colfax Massacre of 1873, where 150 black men were murdered for congregating at a courthouse? Or the 1898 Wilmington Race Riot, where black participation in the government led whites to make a white Declaration of Independence, overthrowing the local government, killing hundreds of blacks? Or the Atlanta Massacre of 1906, which saw a death toll of over 100? White violence towards blacks took the form of massacres and lynchings throughout the United States. Blacks were pushed out of white American society, and when they created successful towns, they were destroyed. Add that to the government's discriminatory housing policies, and you have a recipe for destruction.
Yes, and they used to call it Black Wall Street. and but it wasn't Wall Street, but you know, yeah, it was a prosperous community. Well, I'm 95, and I was 6 years old at the time of the disaster. Whites decided to burn down the homes of 10,000 people. So that was not a riot. It was planned desecration. We were just small children, and my family had not told me about prejudice and hate and things like that. I thought everything in the preamble to the Constitution referred to me. It was 80 years before the state of Oklahoma actually had a commission to study it and remove the blame from us as victims and put the blame where it belonged, on the Ku Klux Klan.
We don't hate the Negro. God made him black, and he made us white. And you will find this laid out in the 11th chapter of Genesis, in which he segregated the races. And we, knowing that for 5,000 years the white man has been the supreme race, we, the Knights of the Ku Klux Klan, intend to keep it the white race.
The promises of equal treatment under law and the hopes of participating in a world where freedom reigns were dashed during and after Reconstruction. By the time the civil rights movement began in the 1950s, promises of fair treatment, equality, and voting were but distant dreams from a forgotten past. Although the South usually serves as our example of racism and hatred, blacks also face deep levels of discrimination in the North and throughout the United States. Segregation was the law of the land and was ruled by the Supreme Court as constitutional in the Plessy v. Ferguson case of 1896. Its dismantling would become one of the main focuses of the civil rights movement. The start of the civil rights movement is said to have began with Rosa Parks and her refusal to give her seat up to a white man on the bus. Rosa Parks is legendary, but most people focus solely on what she did on the bus. Some even jokingly say that she was just tired, yet few know what she did before that fateful moment. In her own words, she said,
"I was not sitting in the front of the bus, as so many people have said, and neither was my feet hurting, as many people have said. But I had made up my mind that I would not give in any longer to legally enforced racial segregation."
Before she stepped foot on that bus in 1955, Parks was heavily involved in the civil rights movement for many years, working as secretary of the Montgomery chapter of the NAACP for 12 years before her arrest, organizing committees for equal justice and becoming involved in civil rights court cases. She even attended a school that taught activists how to fight for racial equality. Rosa Parks was not a tired little old lady. She was a revolutionary-minded freedom fighter. Years before her arrest, Parks had a bad interaction with a bus driver named James Blake. In Montgomery, it was customary for blacks to pay their bus fare at the front, exit the bus, and then re-enter from the back where the colored seats were located, instead of paying and walking past white seats. In 1943, Blake instructed Rosa to pay her fare and re-enter from the back. After she exited the bus, James Blake drove off without her. Parks swore to never ride his bus again. She didn't know that he would be the bus driver that led to her arrest. It is possible to think that this earlier interaction influenced her decision to disobey Blake's orders. On December 1st, 1955, Parks paid her bus fare and sat down in the colored section. After the whites only seats filled up, the bus driver, James Blake, ordered Rosa and three other black people to vacate their seats. They complied, but Rosa felt a determination to stay. In her head was the story of Emmett Till, the black teenager who had been killed after allegedly flirting with a white woman in August of the same year. Just days earlier, Rosa had learned of the acquittal of the two men who killed Emmett Till. The story devastated her, but it also gave her resolve to fight the system.
When asked if she was going to get up, Parks refused. Blake then threatened to call the police, to which Rosa replied, "You may do that." Rosa was arrested and charged with violating Montgomery's segregation law. She was bailed out the same day by Edgar Nixon, the president of the Montgomery NAACP that she worked for. Days later, she was found guilty of disorderly conduct and violating a local ordinance. Nixon quickly organized a boycott and chose a young, unknown local pastor to lead it, Martin Luther King. By December 7th, FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover ordered agents to find information to discredit the young minister. The boycott had a devastating effect on Montgomery's public transit system. People carpooled, hitchhiked, rode with black taxi drivers, and walked miles every day. During the boycott, Dr. King's house was firebombed with his wife Coretta Scott and baby daughter Yolanda. Neither were harmed. The incident served to highlight King's commitment to nonviolence as he immediately spoke out against retaliation. King also spent 2 weeks in jail, bringing him national notoriety and placing him as a young leader of the black community. The boycott lasted 381 days, ending in victory when the United States Supreme Court declared Alabama's segregation laws for buses to be unconstitutional. This major triumph was not simply limited to buses in Alabama. It sparked life into the civil rights movement, beginning a renewed era in the fight for black rights. Rosa wasn't a tired old lady.
We are denied not only civil rights, but even human rights. So the only way we're going to get some of this oppression and exploitation away from us or aside from us is come together against a common enemy.
Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right.
Good evening. Dr. Martin Luther King, the apostle of nonviolence in the civil rights movement, has been shot to death in Memphis, Tennessee.
I turned around quickly, and the next thing I saw was Malcolm falling back in a dead faint.
What the hell do white men wear with that?
Why would he?
He got respect. That's he meant something to me. That's why I'm down here.
That's right.
What's going to happen now, do you think?
What's going to happen? You're going to get hurt. Your people, my people, is going to be a whole lot of hurt before this whole thing is over. That's what I think.
Because of this death.
Yeah, but the question is, Molly, how do you get there? Do you get there by confrontation, violence?
Oh, is that the question you were asking?
Yeah.
I grew up in Birmingham, Alabama. Some very, very good friends of mine were killed by bombs that were planted by racists. From the time I was very small, I remember the sounds of bombs exploding across the street, our house shaking. The man who was at that time in complete control of the city government, his name was Bull Connor, would often get on the radio and make statements like, "Niggers have moved into a white neighborhood, we better expect some bloodshed tonight." And sure enough, there would be bloodshed. In fact, when the bombing occurred, one of the mothers of one of the young girls called my mother and said, "Can you take me down to the church to pick up Carol? We heard about the bombing and I don't have my car." And they went down, and what did they find? They found limbs and heads strewn all over the place. And when you live under a situation like that constantly, and then you ask me, you know, whether I approve of violence. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense at all.
That is why we are witnessing the resurrection of...
After the assassination of Malcolm X and the police killing of Matthew Johnson, an unarmed black man, Huey Newton and Bobby Seale co-founded the Black Panthers. Originating from Oakland, California in 1966, its initial purpose was to monitor police in local black communities in order to combat police brutality. By 1969, the Panthers organized community programs providing food, education, and health clinics, among other activities. At its peak, The Panthers had over 5,000 members and had offices all throughout the United States. Known for their bold, unapologetically pro-black ideology, the Panthers called for an end to police brutality, advocated for equality in housing, employment, and education, as well as advocating for blacks to control their own communities and the electing of black officials. Women were an integral part of the Panthers, at times leading the organization, while constituting two-thirds of its members. They were strong, smart, revolutionary, and beautiful. Dressed in all black with afros, black fists held high, often seen carrying weapons to defend from a brutal government. The Black Panthers were feared, known by FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover as the greatest threat to the internal security of the country. This from the same man who called Dr. King an enemy of the state. Black Panthers made use of California's open carry laws that allowed individuals to carry loaded rifles as long as they were displayed and not aimed at anyone. Police would be monitored from afar as they drove throughout black communities in order to prevent or stop unlawful police violence. This resulted in the Mulford Act of 1967, which repealed California's open carry laws in an attempt to disarm the Black Panthers. In protest, 30 Black Panthers armed themselves and went to the California State House. The nation was horrified. The Panthers' protest inadvertently helped pass the Mulford Act, which was signed into law by Governor Ronald Reagan, along with a measure outlawing firearms at the state capitol. This led to a wave of gun control regulations aimed mostly at blacks. The National Rifle Association worked closely with the U.S. government to pass strict gun regulations, all in response to the Black Panthers' lawful use of firearms. The government persecuted the Black Panthers both openly and covertly. Members were constantly watched, unlawfully imprisoned, harassed, and manipulated. Despite this, the Panthers only had a few violent run-ins with the law, which in many cases appeared to be incited and covered up by the government itself. Unfortunately, these incidents were and still are used to characterize the Black Panthers as militant thugs, instead of a revolutionary source of protection in the face of state-mandated violence. At its worst, the FBI orchestrated a police raid on the home of 21-year-old Panther leader Fred Hampton. Hampton was asleep with his pregnant fiancée when he was shot twice in the head. An autopsy revealed that Hampton had been drugged the night before. A former FBI agent has since revealed that Hampton was drugged by an FBI informant in a plot to assassinate him. Hampton was unconscious at the time of his murder. Another Panther was killed in the raid, and seven others were beaten, arrested, and charged with attempted murder of the officers conducting the raid. The media was told that the Panthers shot first and disobeyed multiple orders to cease fire. While an investigation revealed that only one shot came from the Panthers and 80 came from the police. And this is what they based their fear of the Panthers' legacy on. Lies. They say the Panthers were like a black version of the KKK. This couldn't be any further from the truth. It was called the Black Panther Party for self-defense for a reason. But for those who choose to fight against the government's oppression, you have summoned the demon, and it will destroy you in a way you can't understand.
You are the ones who are gonna decide for yourselves what happened in that apartment on the morning of December 4th. You're going to decide whether or not Fred Hampton and Mark Clark were the victims of premeditated murder.
Thereafter, three times, Sergeant Groth ordered all his men to cease firing and told the occupants to come out with their hands up.
And yet the federal grand jury concludes that only one possible shot could have come from a Panther weapon. It would have us believe that even though there was only one Panther shot, they called for a ceasefire on three different occasions and didn't get it, and so they continued their firing.
This is where our chairman had his brains blown out as he lay in his bed, sleeping at 4:30 in the morning.
Still half asleep, I looked up and I saw bullets coming from, it looked like, the front of the apartment, from the kitchen area. They were, pigs were just shooting. mattress is just going. You could feel bullets going into it. I just knew he'd be dead, everybody in there. When he looked up, just looked up, he didn't say a word, and he didn't move, except for moving his head up. He laid his head back down. At that time, I was 8.5 to 9 months pregnant. My baby was to be delivered in 2 weeks. Pigs kept on shooting.
My recruitment by the FBI was very efficient, very simple, really. I'd stolen a car and went joyriding over the state limit. And they had a potential case against me, and I was looking for an opportunity to work it off. FBI agent Roy Mitchell asked me to go down to the local office of the Black Panther Party and try to gain membership. We tried to develop negative information to discredit him, just like we did everybody else. We, meaning the FBI, I tried to come up with signs of him doing drugs or something, and never could. He was clean. He was dedicated. I've had private conversations with him. We got along pretty well. Mitchell became more specific during that time. He needed to know who was staying at what locations. We both were speechless. We just walked through the house and saw where what had taken place and where he died, and it was shocking. And then I was, you know, I just began to realize that the information that I supplied leading up to that moment had facilitated that raid.
Black organizations were routinely surveilled, discredited, infiltrated, and violently silenced by the United States government. They had been doing so for decades, but in 1956, the FBI made their operations official with the creation of the Counterintelligence Program, better known as COINTELPRO. Initially, COINTELPRO was created to infiltrate the Communist Party of USA, but was also used to justify the surveillance of black leaders and organizations under the assumption that they too had been influenced by communists. COINTELPRO's stated goals were to expose, disrupt, misdirect, discredit, or otherwise neutralize individuals deemed as enemies of the state. A 1968 memo from longtime FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover specifically addressed what the government called black nationalist hate groups. In it, Hoover states that COINTELPRO must prevent the rise of a messiah who could unify and electrify the militant black nationalist movement. In unity, there is strength. The memo then mentions Malcolm X, who had already been assassinated, Martin Luther King, Stokely Carmichael, and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad as possible messiah figures. What did they mean by prevent the rise of a messiah? A messiah is a leader or savior of a particular group or cause. In this case, it was an individual who had the ability to inspire the black community to continually fight for and gain true freedom and equality. That is what the government was trying to stop. So what did COINTELPRO actually do? FBI agents infiltrated organizations to destroy them from within. They made anonymous phone calls to their targets, providing them with false information, often accusing other black groups of wrongdoing in order to discourage unity. They conducted illegal break-ins. They used the media to destroy public opinion on target groups. They created movements led by FBI agents. Hoover encouraged agents to make up information, and they assaulted and assassinated targets, among many other covert actions sanctioned by the government. Evil. COINTELPRO sent a letter to Dr. King accusing him of infidelity and suggesting that he commit suicide before accepting the Nobel Peace Prize. COINTELPRO infiltrated the Nation of Islam, purposely creating division between Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm X, leading to his assassination. COINTELPRO threatened the career of an agent who said that the San Francisco Black Panther Party's main purpose was feeding children. They expected him to find evidence of violent revolution, and when he didn't, they worked to undermine the Panthers' food program. COINTELPRO plotted the assassination of Black Panther leader Fred Hampton. They also controlled and infiltrated many events leading to the deaths of other leaders, including Dr. King and Malcolm X. Let's make it simple. COINTELPRO was a secret war waged by the United States government against blacks who were working towards true equality and freedom. Their supposed goal was to stop violence. Instead, they became that violence. In 1971, an FBI office in Pennsylvania was burglarized by the Citizens Commission to investigate the FBI. They found the COINTELPRO files and exposed them to the media. This led J. Edgar Hoover to declare the end of the program, although the FBI continued to target black organizations. In 2017, a leaked FBI counterterrorism report used the term black identity extremists to describe potentially violent black activists angered by police brutality. Critics believe that this was done to further demonize black movements. Since 2019, the term is no longer in use, and any other covert government operations remain cloaked in darkness. What if COINTELPRO remained a secret? What if we never saw behind the curtain? And even more importantly, what secret activities are they concealing now?
Free me.
An impartial investigative agency dedicated to serving the people of the United States. Its fundamental role, to protect the innocent, to apprehend the guilty. This is your FBI.
Want to join me here? Won't you be seated, please, ladies and gentlemen? Come on, Dr. Jaffe, and Mr. Krogh, Mr. Ehrlich.
Yes, sir. Fine.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to summarize for you the meeting that I have just had with the bipartisan leaders, which began at 8 o'clock and was completed 2 hours later. I began the meeting by making this statement, which I think needs to be made to the nation. America's public enemy number one in the United States is drug abuse. In order to fight and defeat this enemy, it is necessary to wage a new all-out offensive.
Here goes the stuff. Yeah. Boom.
Drugs are menacing our society. They're threatening our values and undercutting our institutions. They're killing our children.
The thrill can kill. Say no to drugs.
Of course, your local drug pusher may tell you a little something different about these drugs. What would I do if someone offered me these drugs? I'd tell him to take a hike.
Getting all of this?
5 seconds ago, I was real tired. Right now, I got energy. I can get up from here now and walk to the moon. Walk to the moon.
We need to take these people on. They are often connected to big drug cartels. They are not just gangs of kids anymore. They are often the kinds of kids that are called super predators. No conscience, no empathy. We can talk about why they ended up that way, but first we have to bring them to heel.
Do you regret your advocacy for the crime bill?
Well, look, I supported the crime bill. My husband has apologized. He was the president who actually signed it. I'm sorry for the consequences that were unintended and that have had a very unfortunate impact on people's lives.
It doesn't matter whether or not they were deprived as a youth. It doesn't matter or not whether or not they had no background that enabled them to become socialize into the fabric of society. It doesn't matter whether or not they're the victims of society. The end result is they're about to knock my mother on the head with a lead pipe, shoot my sister, beat up my wife, take on my sons. So I don't want to ask what made them do this. They must be taken off the street. Tens of thousands of them, born out of wedlock, without parents, without supervision, without any structure, without any conscience developing, we should focus on them now. If we don't, they will, or a portion of them will, become the predators 15 years from now.
You ashamed of that bill?
Not at all. In fact, I drafted the bill, as you remember.
I know that.
And by the way, we talk about this mostly in terms of Black Lives Matter. Black lives really do matter, but the problem is institutional racism in America. That's the overarching problem that still exists. And we should be talking about it. And you look at it, the legacy of racism in housing and jobs and so on. So.
To call your own citizens super predators is pretty harsh and, you know, and it's pretty big indictment. You know, it's just like the term thug or hoodlum. You know, it's just an easy brush to paint somebody with. Now you have, you know, the people or the authorities feel like, okay, now they're justified in how they treat these so-called super predators. And what is that? Who is that? I mean, specifically, who are you talking about? If I'm a Black kid that's not in a gang, but I look like a gang member to this white officer, then it's a war on me.
I'm going to close by saying this. This report is not credible. Why do I do all of this? Because I want to find some CIA operatives, assets, or agents and somehow convict them. That's not going to happen. The least we could do is develop public policy that will indicate that drug trafficking can never be used in any covert operation, no matter what is being attempted. And we find more information about drug trafficking, and either the CIA absolutely knowing or turning its head. At the same time, we're spending millions of dollars talking about a war on drugs. Give me a break, Mr. Chairman and members. My community has been devastated, as many communities across this nation. People are outraged and concerned about the fact that somehow this drug problem won't go away and the idea that the government could be involved.
To the moon, moon, moon.
We have a poem here. It's called Whitey on the Moon. And it was inspired by some whiteys on the moon. So I want to give credit where credit is due.
A rat done bit my sister Nell with Whitey on the Moon. Her face and arms began to swell and Whitey's on the moon. I can't pay no doctor bills, but Whitey's on the moon. 10 years from now, I'll be paying still while Whitey's on the moon. You know, the man just upped my rent last night, cause Whitey's on the moon. No hot water, no toilets, no lights, but Whitey's on the moon. I wonder why he's upping me. Cause Whitey's on the moon? Well, I was already giving him 50 a week, and now Whitey's on the moon. Taxes taking my whole damn check. The junkies make me a nervous wreck. The price of food is going up. And as if all that crap wasn't enough, a rat done bit my sister Nell with Whitey on the moon. Her face and arms began to swell, and Whitey's on the moon. Was all that money I made last year for Whitey on the moon? How come I ain't got no money here? Whitey's on the moon. You know, I just about had my fill of Whitey on the moon. I think I'll send these doctor bills, air mail special. To Whitey on the moon.
See, our relationship has increased a tonfold these here few years. And I'm so happy and lucky to feel that we is finally getting it together. And you know where I'm coming from?
Today, we are witnessing the legacy of what centuries of deliberate destruction looks like, but still we rise. Systemic racism has affected all areas of life and can be clearly seen within statistics. Black men are 2.5 times more likely to be killed by police than white men. Black people are 13% of the population, but make up 40% of the prison population. Marijuana usage rates between blacks and whites are similar, but black people are 3.64 times more likely to be arrested for it and generally receive longer sentences for the same crime. The average black worker earned 62% of what the average white worker made. Every white family's $1 equals the black family's 1 cent. Black home ownership rates are the lowest out of any demographic at 44% versus 73.7% of whites. 20.8% of the black community lives in poverty versus only 8.1% of whites. Non-white schools receive $23 billion less in state and local funding than predominantly white schools in 2016. Only 57% of black students have access to a full range of college readiness courses compared to 71% of white students. African American students are often located in schools with less qualified teachers who have low salaries. Black women are 3 times more likely to die giving birth than white women. Also, in the age of COVID, black people are severely overrepresented, making up 33% of COVID hospitalizations and 23% of the deaths. This is but a small sample of the issues we face today. Yet anyone who claims that the past has no effect on the present is either ignorant or just stupid. They are also suggesting that black people are inferior because they feel like they've given us the perfect environment to flourish in, but the majority of us just can't seem to make it. Devil.
Don't be surprised when the devil does what demons do. You enslaved us. You raped our women. You denied our freedom while fighting for yours. You segregated us into slums. You pillaged our towns. When we marched, you unleashed vicious dogs on us. You killed our leaders. You infiltrated organizations created to defend us from your tyranny. You targeted us through a false war on drugs while you were accused of distributing mass amounts of drugs to our communities. Unarmed people are murdered and the killers walk free. And then you miseducate us about our history. Black woman, black man, why are you not patriotic enough? Don't you know what this nation has done for you? Things were kind of bad, but that's all in the past. A revolution is coming.
They say it in the spirit of liberation. I've been gone for a little while. At least my body's been gone for a little while. But I'm back now, and I believe that I'm back to stay.
The resurrection of...
Yeah! Is a felony a revolution? Yeah! Well, I was sent to start a revolution.
singing and marching wasn't cutting it. Now I'm sending threats straight to the government. They call it treason. Well, no, it isn't. When you black in America, it's family tradition. Martin Luther had them singing back when. Now
dreadlock got them blacks mad again.
Prowling in the streets, the Panthers back again. The popo throwing bullets at my black skin. Stand for the flag, you ain't no African. And I ain't racist, nigga, I got a black friend. I'm pulling up in the black hearse. We pulling up in a black